Thank you very much for the introduction. Thanks, Dr. Yamamoto, for hosting this event, and it's a pleasure for me to be again in Kyoto, in Kyoto University. I've been there in the past. Thanks to David and to Adam for organizing this event here. And thanks for the students, thanks for the young scientists to be there today. I'm going to try to be very ambitious, you know, to start to tell you about this adventure of the discovery of HIV and to move progressively towards the global health challenge that we have to face in the 21st century. So I will start by the identification of the disease itself, AIDS, in 1981. It's, you know, 1981, it was a time that a lot of people were thinking that we will not have to face new emerging infectious disease. And this disease arrived. It was recognized originally in a few homosexual and then in hemophiliac in drug users. So if I'm showing you this slide, it's just to give you a few messages. First one is when you make a discovery like the discovery of this new virus causative agent of a disease like AIDS, as the virologists or researchers, we have to take into consideration the observation of epidemiologists and the observation of clinicians. It's really the clinician who came to us to ask whether we could look for the causative agent of this disease. Second message, when you have an emerging disease like it was the case for AIDS, we have to keep in mind immediately, even if you are a scientist, even a basic scientist in laboratories, how important are the view and the point of view of people affected by this disease. You can see on this slide, You can see on this slide over there a demonstration of people affected by this disease calling for research and not hysteria. They were right. They were totally right. And we have also to keep in mind that this disease, as you know, as I said, was recognized originally in few homosexuals. And it was a start of discrimination, stigma of population. And still today, more than 35 years after the identification of disease, we are still suffering, they are still suffering of stigma and discrimination. So these kind of things that we have to keep in mind when you are working on disease like this one. As I said, we were mobilized at the Institut Pasteur by our colleague, the clinician, Willy Rosenbaum, who was among the clinicians that recognized the first case of AIDS in his hospital in France. And Willy was in contact with the virologists in the hospital, Françoise Barré-Sinoussi and Christine Rousseau. And they started to discuss together about what could be the causative agent of this disease, because they had already, based on the observation of epidemiologists, the idea that probably it was a virus because hemophiliac was affected by this disease. However, they knew also that in the United States, they already had looked for a lot of familiar viruses and none was corresponding to the causative agent. So they came to us at Pasteur with a very simple idea and asking us whether the new identified human retrovirus affecting T lymphocyte HTLV, human T cell leukemia virus, which was identified in US and by the way also here in Japan, could be the cause of this new emerging disease. And they came to us because they knew that at Pasteur we were working on animal retroviruses. We said it's a very interesting hypothesis, but we don't believe in HTLV. HTLV is a virus that transforms the cells. The cells that are infected by this virus proliferate. This virus is causing leukemia. However, we have the technology in our hands to try to find out whether a virus from this family could be associated with the disease. So it was a very, very important meeting and discussion together with our colleagues. That was in December 1982. And we asked very simple questions like when to look for such a virus, where to look, and how to look for it. And I indicated, and that is really for the young students and scientists, never have any dogma. Be very open-minded. Because if we were at followed the hypothesis of our colleague, we would have looked for HTLV. And we would have missed the identification of the causative agent. So we decide together with our colleague clinicians that the best time will be probably to look before the patient develop AIDS, pre-AIDS symptom. They say before they develop AIDS, they have generalized lymphadenopathy, and we say, oh, that's it. This is a reaction against the infectious agent. So probably the virus should be in the lymph node. Can we have a lymph node of a patient? And Willie said to us, I think I have a patient probably will accept to have a lymph node biopsy only for research. That was the beginning of a very, very strong and extensive collaboration with the patient themselves. So it's how we started. We started to put in the culture the lymphocyte isolated from the lymph node. And soon after, we had the detection of the retrovirus in the culture. This is what was published in the paper, science paper in May 1983, reporting the isolation of the virus we call at that time lymphadenopathy-associated virus because it was isolated from a patient with generalized lymphadenopathy, and because also we did not have at the time, in May 1983, the strong evidence that the virus was the causative agent of AIDS. It's really between during the year of 1983 that we accumulate the evidence. So that was more than 30 years ago. A lot of progress has been made since the identification of the virus and the establishment of the link between the virus and the disease itself. So I'm showing you this slide, which are trying to represent main milestone in HIV science. I used to say that HIV science, by the way, it's a very good example of what we call today translational science, trying to make progress in our scientific knowledge in order to deliver tools for the benefit of the patients. So I'm not going to go in detail of this slide because that will be too long, and anyway, not everything is really written. It's impossible to write on one slide all the discovery and findings that has been made all over the year. I just ask you to look for the color. Of course, the color starts with blue. Blue is what we can say basic science. It's followed by green on the slide. Green is the development of treatment or monitoring of treatment in patients. The pink on this slide is tools to prevent against the infection. You can see, even in the back, I guess, that after starting by the blue, you have the pink appearing, and then you started to have also the pink appearing after the green. That means that based on the knowledge of the virus, of the target cell of the virus, of the replication cycle of the virus, it's how the development of drug like AZT, the first one, on which a Japanese guy has been working very importantly. AZT was the first drug as a reverse transcriptase inhibitor capable to block the replication of the virus and was first tried in patients infected by HIV. Very soon after, we found out, however, that AZT alone was not sufficient because the patients were developing resistance to antiretroviral treatment. And we had to wait 1996 to have the wonderful data of combination of three drugs, including a protease inhibitor, capable to block the replication of the virus in the patients without emergence of resistance to treatment. So the first data on efficacy of antiretroviral treatment. However, meanwhile, you can see here the pink. PMTCT, prevention of mother-to-child transmission in 1994. I very often like to remember everyone that this data in 1994 were the first data showing that antiretroviral treatment is also prevention. Since for the first time, AZT was shown to prevent mother-to-child transmission. So you see that all over the years, the pink is increasing, but still we do not have a vaccine. We have made progress in terms of prevention by circumcision and by other means. But you can see also on this slide, the point that I want to stress, the blue reappearing. The blue reappearing because if we want to make progress for developing new treatment, for developing a vaccine, that will be based on finding in basic science again. So as I said, 1996 was the beginning of a new era with this combined antiretroviral therapy, with these molecules that were developed based on our knowledge of the replication cycle, reverse transcriptase inhibitor first, but then molecules blocking the different step of the replication cycle were developed, and a combination of three drugs was shown to stop the replication of the virus, to restore at least partially the immune function, to prevent the development of the disease, to improve the quality of life, and to also prevent transmission. This was really great for the patients and for everybody. During the year, progress has been made in prevention as well. On this slide, on your right, you have what I called the traditional prevention tool, like condom, like treatment of sexually transmitted infection, like, of course, counseling, testing, like behavioral intervention, and even circumcision, which has been shown to reduce by 60% the risk of infection by HIV. And on your left, you have the new measure that can be used also to be combined with other preventative approaches. They are all based on use of antiretroviral treatment as prevention, either early treatment to prevent the infection, and it has been clearly shown by a very large trial in the United States, the HBTN 052, that if someone is infected by HIV, treated very early on, we can reduce the risk for him to transmit to his or her partner by 96%. So very efficient prevention. Secondly, there are several tools that has been developed, including antiretroviral treatment. For example, gel with antiretroviral drug or vaginal ring for women with antiretroviral drug to try to give a tool for women to prevent herself from infection. Pills for oral pre-exposure prophylaxis, PrEP. PrEP, you know, during the last 2 years, it has been wonderful data on PrEP showing that if the gay population who is taking still risk for infection is taking the PrEP, then they can reduce their risk of infection by 86%. This is also wonderful tools for them. Finally, we know since already several years that using antiretroviral treatment as post-exposure prophylaxis is also working. What I want to mention on this slide is that you can see the efficacy of this antiretroviral prophylaxis in a range of 0 to 90%. Why is zero? It's zero because when it's not working, it's because the population using PrEP is not adherent to this approach. Otherwise, we have almost 90% prevention. What is the future? The future will be certainly long-lasting antiretroviral treatment used as a PrEP. There are already some data, encouraging data, with such a long-lasting drug, and that will be used for PrEP, but also certainly for treatment. What has been the result? Wonderful result in impact, an impact on survival and HIV transmission as shown on this slide. For example, if you look before the antiretroviral treatment, the expectancy of life of a 20 years old person living with HIV was plus 8 years. Today, we can say it's plus 55 years, which means about the same as someone who is not infected by HIV, which is really wonderful. You can see on this slide that globally since 2005, it has been 50 reduction of AIDS-associated deaths thanks to the antiretroviral drug. We can see also that we are more than 30% reduction of new HIV infection. And here on the right, you see a decrease of the incidence of HIV infection in South Africa since they are using antiretroviral drug. So clearly, it has been a lot of progress in the access of antiretroviral treatment since 2000s, and thanks to the international effort, this international will not have been possible without the action of our colleagues, the activists, who have made a lot of pressure, as you know, on government, on pharma, in order to reduce the price of the antiretroviral drug to make them available for all. Thanks also for political leaders like Nelson Mandela, shown on this slide, who has made, you know, very important statement in order to make pressure on his own government, Professor Mbeki, who at that time, you know, many years ago, were saying that HIV was not the cause of AIDS. So, a lot of progress, and last year, in 2015, for the first time, the objective of WHO UNAIDS was reached. 15 million of people on antiretroviral treatment in 2015. That's really wonderful. That's not enough. That's not enough because even if the coverage is increasing, as you can see on this slide, There is a lot of heterogeneity in terms of access to antiretroviral treatment. There are too few countries today which have more than 80% of their people infected by HIV on treatment. So WHO and UNAIDS decided to have a new and very ambitious goal, which is what we call the 90-90-90 targets. What does that mean? The goal is as follows. We have about 37 million of people infected by HIV in the world. First goal is to diagnose 90% of people who are infected by HIV. The second target is to treat 90% of the people who are diagnosed by infected by HIV. And the third target is to maintain 90% of the persons who are on treatment, and that means that they will be virologically suppressed. Of course, it's a very ambitious goal. The question is whether it is achievable and sustainable. We don't know. But I used to say, you know, if we want to be as close as possible to a goal, the goal should be very ambitious. What are the main challenges that we have to face to reach this goal? We certainly have to do better in terms of prevention of new infection, and we have to do better in terms of testing, treating, and retaining into the treatment. I mentioned on this slide that according to the country, we have between 30 to 50% of people that do not know that they are HIV infected. We also know by several studies made in different countries in the world, if you look for the continuum of care, we have only 25% to 60% of people on long term who are virologically suppressed. That means that a larger proportion of patients are stopping their treatment for different reasons. I generally ask to students or young researchers, where are the 25%? And the answer generally to me, Africa. No, Africa, yes, in some places, but very few. 25% in the United States of America. So, I mean, it's not only a question of effort, it's not only a question of funding. It's a question also of access to drug and also adherence to drug. It's a question of strengthening the health system and services. As you know, in the United States, there is still a lot of problem for the minority to have access to health services. It's a question of linking prevention and care and treatment services. It's a question of leadership and governance in the countries. We need to have a better strategy integrating all the components of prevention, care, and treatment. We need still to have innovation across the continuum of care to optimize the care package, for example, to have a long-acting drug that I mentioned before probably will make a progress and will make certainly the difference. We already made the difference in terms of diagnosis, having in our hands self-diagnosis available as well as very rapid tests that the community by themselves can use. And certainly we have to develop the community delivery and support system in all the countries in the world. So it's a question of improving the implementation, improving the public health program in general, but that will be possible only if we have political willingness, if we have international investment, if we fight against stigma, discrimination, if we fight against repressive measures that still exist in more than 70 countries in the world for key affected population. this is not acceptable at all. So, the end of it, the end of it is still an aspirational vision. It's still an aspirational vision, and if we want really to have an elimination and eradication of AIDS and HIV infection, is not for today. It's not for today because we made a lot of progress, but still we do not have a cure, we do not have a vaccine. However, we have tools in our hands to have a control of the epidemic. And as you can see on this slide, indeed, if we use this tool in particular, we will be able to decrease significantly the incidence of HIV infection in the world. That means that control of HIV epidemic is really achievable. And if we want now to eliminate, let's work on vaccine and cure. Vaccine and cure, this is the challenges for the coming years in science, in HIV science. It has been a lot of progress in terms of HIV vaccine discovery since 2009. We learned a lot from the Thai trial, which showed for the first time a 30% reduction of infection in vaccinees with a combination of two vaccines. Certainly not sufficient to say that we have a vaccine, but we learn from those vaccinees who has been protected. Secondly, cure. Cure, it's a very, very difficult challenge. We'll talk a little bit about it. And I cannot really separate HIV cure research from research on trying to avoid what we call the non-AIDS-related comorbidities. Patients that are on long-term, on heart, developing aging disease, developing cancer, developing cardiovascular disease. And we know that they represent between 8 to 10% of people who are infected on treatment. So if we want to move forward, we need to have a better knowledge in HIV basic science on HIV latency, immunology, and HIV pathogenesis, and then we will be able to develop novel strategy for vaccine and for cure. Significant progress, as I said, has been made in the field of vaccine. Scientists in particular in the United States have identified new, very, very potent, broadly neutralizing antibody. Originally, they were identified in a very small proportion of people infected by HIV who are carrying those antibodies. Those patients are called the elite neutralizers. The antibody from those patients has been structurally and functionally characterized. And from the structure of these antibodies, the scientists have been able to construct antibodies that are broadly neutralizing, which are targeting several regions of the envelope protein of the virus, which is represented here on this slide. Several of these antibodies are now in clinics with very interesting data in terms of passive immunization. But we also learned, in particular from the Thai trial, that there are also antibodies that might be involved in protection, but are non-neutralizing antibodies. So we are learning more and more about the efficient immune response which is required to get protection. So we are moving to structure-based immunogen design, novel delivery system. We are moving also into genetic engineering and gene transfer in T cells in order to improve the T cell response and protective immune response in following vaccination. We are learning more and more also on the importance of innate immunity in driving the protective immune response. And so there is new development in the field of vaccine science. And I like to say that in opposite to the past, we are moving from an empiric approach to a very much more rational approach, a strategy which integrates both basic and clinical science, and we are enhanced today, wonderful technology and new concepts, and I'm very much believe personally that fighting against the dogma that neutralizing antibodies are the response which is needed for protection, probably yes, but not only. So I'm sure that we'll have new vaccine discovery. New vaccine discovery in the field of HIV, but probably not only HIV, because as you know, HIV reminded us how much, how many vaccines that we do not have, like hepatitis C, like herpes, many malaria, of course. And some vaccines are not very efficient, like BCG, for example, for TB. So that means that indeed we need some more basic science in order really to understand better what is the mechanism are needed to have protective immune response. Regarding the cure, to move fast now. The cure, I used to say when people say, why are you pushing so much HIV cure science? We have a treatment, the treatment is working. I say, the answer is easy, ask the patient. Ask the patient who are on treatment if they want what they want, what they are looking, what they are expecting from us, the scientists. And this guy, Fred Vermuth, did it. He did it in his country, Netherlands. He made a small survey originally, but since then, several other surveys have been made. He asked the people living with HIV on treatment, doing very well in Netherlands, as you can imagine, with a quite a very nice quality of life. Is it important for you to have a cure? 70% of them say, oh yes, it's very important. So then he asks, why? And the answer were vast majority saying not to be anxious anymore about our future. Not to deal anymore with stigma and discrimination, because even if we are on treatment, even if we are doing well, we feel stigmatized. And finally, we are really still afraid to transmit the virus to others. So the answer is there. If the patients want to have novel therapeutic strategy, we have to work on it. In addition, as I said before, we have 37 million of people infected. Only 17% of them are on treatment today. That's not enough. Even if we should make progress in the access to antiretroviral treatment, we know that this treatment is lifelong treatment. We know that on long term, it's very difficult for the patient to remain adherent to the treatment. We know how difficult it is in some country to have a constant procurement of antiretroviral drug. We know that on long term, it could be toxicity, could be non-AIDS, also mortality, as I said before. And we know that it's a very high cost. And that is a real problem for sustainability of the actual treatment. So we have to think about novel strategy. Why it's so difficult? Why it's so difficult? Why do we need, and the patients need to take this treatment for lifelong? It's because the virus is persisting, even on treatment. And we learned that since several studies that has been made of treatment interruption in patients. You can see on this slide, this is a summary, when you start to treat patients, their viral load decreases to an undetectable level in their plasma. However, if we stop, if the patient stops the treatment, within 2 to 8 weeks, you can see a viral rebound in their blood, which correspond to the virus that replicate again. And we know today why. We know today why because the virus remain in latent forms in the cells, in the body, in different compartments of the bodies. And as soon as the patient stops the treatment, the cells are reactivated and the virus replicate again. It's what we call the reservoir of HIV. We learn also from different groups that this reservoir is established very early on after exposure to the virus, within the first weeks, and I should say within the first days after exposure to the virus. Indeed, these studies made in a monkey model indicate that 3 days after infection, it's already the beginning of establishment of the reservoir. We know that this reservoir and the spreading of this reservoir in the different compartments of the body is depending on activation, inflammation. Immune activation and inflammation cannot be separate, indeed, of the replication of the virus and of the spreading of the reservoir. And this abnormal inflammation and immune activation is also induced very early after exposure to the virus, within a few weeks after exposure to the virus. So we have learned a lot in terms of determinant of HIV pathogenesis. We have learned a lot during the last year about HIV latency. We are learning more and more regarding the cells that are latently infected. We know that the major reservoir are resting central and transitional CD4 memory T cells. We know that they are not the only cells to serve as a reservoir. And the list is very long, as you can see here, naive T cell, memory stem T cells, T follicular helper cells, myeloid cells, astrocytes, hematopoietic progenitor cells. And those cells are present not only in the blood, those cells are present in different compartments. They are present in the gut, they are present in genital tract, they are present in lymphoid tissue, in the central nervous system. We know that this reservoir continue to be there because even on treatment, there is residual level of virus replication, not in the blood. Cannot detect it in the blood, but we can detect in some compartment of the virus. We know that those cells that contain the virus in the genome, those cells survive. In addition, we learned during the last years that there is a homeostatic proliferation of the latently infected cells, a clonal expansion of those cells that are latently infected, with the expression at the surface of the cells that correspond to reservoir of immune checkpoint molecules like PD-1, LAG-3, CTLA-4, molecules that indeed are expressed on tumor cells. So we have similarities between the cells that are latently infected by HIV and tumor cells. This has to be taken in consideration for the development of future treatment. So, as I said before, HIV infection is clearly characterized by a chronic inflammation early after exposure, which may play a role in the exhaustion of the regenerative capacity of the cells. Immune checkpoint molecules might be involved, as well as immunosenescence and lymphoid tissue damage, in particular, as we know now, in the gut. This residual chronic inflammation that remains even on treatment is playing a role in HIV persistence, but it's certainly playing a role also in non-AIDS comorbidity, disease, cardiovascular disease, cancer, osteoporosis, aging disease, let's say, in general, that we see on the proportion of patients on treatment. So it's not going to be easy to have a cure. It's not going to be easy at all. And I used to say that cure means, in reality, that we should be able, by a treatment, to eliminate all cells that are latently infected in all the compartments of the body. It's, I like to say very often, it's almost impossible mission. It's impossible mission, however, we have one case, the Berlin patient. It's the only case in the world of someone who received a bone marrow transplant, two bone marrow transplants, because he developed leukemia when he was HIV infected on treatment, and seems to be cured today. I personally believe it's going to be difficult today to have a cure. However, I think it's really possible to have what we can call remission if we use the same word as in cancer. Remission, that will mean that we will have a persistent reduction and control of HIV in the body, with long-term health, without any treatment anymore, and without the risk to transmit to others, since the virus will be uncontrolled. That will be already great. And we believe that's possible. We believe that's possible because we have several examples of natural control of HIV infection. First in monkey, in African monkey. African monkeys are infected. The virus replicates, but they do not develop any disease. And we know that is related to an attenuated immune activation and attenuated inflammation in the monkey. It's about the same in HIV controllers. HIV controllers are a very small proportion of patients. There are less than 5% of people infected by HIV. They never develop the disease. They never receive any antiretroviral treatment. They have a particular genetic background. Most of them, 80% of them, are HLA-B57, B27. As a consequence of this genetic background, they have a very efficient CDH response capable control the infection. But also, this CDH response is associated with a particular activation of innate immune response, in particular a subpopulation of NK cells. Like monkey, they have a lower T cell activation and inflammation. But the one who certainly have the lower inflammation and the immune activation in human are the patient we call the Visconti patient. Those patients are cases, natural cases of remission. They were infected by HIV. They were diagnosed during the primary infection with very, very bad clinical symptoms. They were treated immediately during their primary infection. They stayed on treatment for 3 years. Their virus was perfectly well controlled on treatment, and they asked the doctor, can we stop our treatment? Because you cannot detect the virus anymore in us. We are doing fine. Can we stop? The doctor said, okay, if you promise me to come regularly to check. They did, and now 21% of these patients are still without any treatment. They are doing perfectly fine. And in addition, we have a teenager which is in about the same situation. She was a baby infected by her mother, treated at birth, and she is still in remission now. It's 13 years that she is in remission. So it's possible. it's possible, so it's the reason why we say let's try to accelerate. Let's try to accelerate research on HIV cure. It's what we did at the International AIDS Society, trying to convene 30 and now 60 scientists in the world to define a scientific agenda, priorities in HIV cure research. We published the first scientific agenda in 2012 in Nature Review in Immunology, and we made an update this year, published it in August 2016 in Nature Medicine. We are defined in this agenda as a priority, and we are all convinced that in the future the cure strategy will be a combined strategy, probably combining what we call the shock and kill approach, trying to use latency reversing agents, similar for some of them, again, of drugs used in cancer, playing a role in epigenetic mechanics, to associate with a treatment that will help the immune system to eliminate the cells that are actively, latency is reactivated, broadly neutralizing antibody as part of it, but also treatment like the one in cancer, anti-PD-1, for example, and we have several studies going on of patients who develop cancer and are HIV infected, treated by anti-PD-1, and we will see whether we can reduce the size of the reservoir in those patients. We probably will have to associate also maybe with gene therapy, and there are several studies that already started in gene therapy. But if we want really to move forward, we need to have really a strategy integrating all the components of science, basic science, preclinical and clinical science. We need to have also social science, because we need to know what patients are ready to accept, yes or no, for future therapy. We need to have the engagement of the community of people living with HIV, because we are not in the same situation as in the early 90s or late 80s. Patients are doing well on treatment today, so it's quite difficult to propose them to be enrolled in new therapeutic trials. We have to engage other non-HIV researchers to work with us, because as I said, there is some analogy with other diseases related to immune inflammation and immune activation. We need to engage also the private sector to work with us immediately since the very beginning in order to develop the drug of the future. And we need the funding agency to follow the scientific agenda defined by the scientists and to cooperate better all together, as we do in this initiative by a board of representatives with a representative of all the main agencies. So HIV/AIDS, and I will finish on this, HIV/AIDS has been the first largest epidemic of the 20th century. And certainly HIV/AIDS is at the origin of the global health concept. It has reminded us that we will have to face persistently threats of emerging and re-emerging infectious disease. And since then, we already had to face new epidemic, Ebola, and recently Zika as well. There are not new viruses. Ebola was discovered in 1976. Zika is not new. It has been discovered in 1947. Those infections are re-emerging regularly, but they are always present in Africa. So, I mean, we have to keep in mind that it's not because we have such emerging or re-emerging infection in industrialized countries. that those infections are always present in other countries with resource-limited setting. So we have to think that our interests should not grow up only when we are affected ourselves by those infectious diseases. And we have to remember the lesson of HIV. For example, Ebola was clearly the early years of HIV, when I saw, you know, the population stigmatized and running away because they were afraid to carry the virus and to transmit the virus with others. It's not the same virus, it's not the same disease, but the behavior of the population was very similar. And I'm very glad to have seen communities and organizations involved in HIV/AIDS to work on Ebola and to go and to inform and educate the population. I'm very pleased also to see scientists involved in HIV/AIDS social science or HIV/AIDS biomedical research to work also on virus like Ebola, to try to develop a vaccine, to try to develop a new therapeutic approach for Ebola, and to try to understand why there are survivors of Ebola. So it has been a long journey, a lot of lessons from this journey on HIV/AIDS, but keep in mind that we will have to face many other diseases in the future. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Barré-Sinoussi, for sharing us entire story of HIV sciences from the beginning of discovery to the your insights into the future vision of this study. And today, I'm happy to accept your questions to Dr. Barré-Sinoussi.
Thank you for a wonderful lecture. I have one question about your lecture. You mentioned the power your colleague made some great pressure to cut down the cost of the heart, so they can provide to a more low-income country. I think that recently the cost of the drug is getting very high, so. That kind of technique is very useful for like tumor therapy. So how did you succeed getting the price cost down in the HIV?
As I said before, it was really the activists that made a lot of pressure on pharma. The pharma has been, you know, several of the pharma has been very often destroyed in conferences, for example, where they were present in the exhibition centers. It has been a lot of pressure there. In addition to the action, it has been also pressure on governments. Certain governments took very courageous decisions, like the one in Brazil, to mention one. The president of Brazil was the first to decide to develop generic in his country without the authorization at the time. It has been since then, the development of generic, of course, a lot of progress in terms of discussion regarding intellectual properties, decision regarding patent pool, and so on. So it has been a progressive decision and different approaches. Including very, very strong approaches of our colleagues, the activists, but also decision by negotiation with the pharma themselves, and for example, to for each CV, to give you one reality, you know, HCV treatment for cure of HCV is very, very expensive. And there have been discussion since now several years directly with the pharma to decrease the price for access in a resource-limited setting. And it has been already decided to have a special price for resource-limited setting in addition together with the discussion negotiation with pharma, it has been also decided to have generic of HCV treatment. So I think we have learned, probably because of HIV, that to work better also with pharma, and the pharma know perfectly well that if they are not making efforts, what is going to happen? Because the activists are still there, even if they look not so active as they were in the 90s, they are still there. And the same activists working in the past for HIV treatment are working today for HCV cure treatment, and they are ready to work for any other treatment.
Hello, thank you for your great talk. I just have a question about the when you say about the shock and kill strategy. So if patients are like under control on the antiretrovirals, do you have any, I've heard that a bit of a struggle is to, like, no patient wants to take HDAC inhibitors that are going to start this shock sort of strategy. It's hard to find participants to trial these shock agents. So I was just wondering, if do you have any, apart from like a financial incentive, how else can we increase participants in these shock?
Personally, I don't think that giving financial incentive is the solution.
So what is the best way to increase?
To work with representative of patients themselves. It's what we are doing in our international society initiative. The representative of patients are part of our initiative because they are the best to explain to the patient what can be the side effect of the trial in which they will be enrolled, whether they will accept according to the side effects that we can expect. You must realize that, and I'm surprised personally, how much people living with HIV, even if they are doing well on treatment, are ready to be enrolled in novel clinical trials without financial incentive, just to try to have better treatment for themselves, but also for others. I mean, they have been wonderful in collaborators, let's say, in our research, the patients themselves. So it's not so difficult. It's really, for me, it's a question of, it's an ethical issue, really. What can we propose to the patient? It's not only, of course, sometimes they are even ready to accept things that we feel ourselves, researchers, that it's not ethics to propose to them. So HDAC inhibitors, it has been already several studies made. We feel that we should not continue HDAC inhibitors alone because the data are not convincing. It could be side effect also of the HDAC inhibitors. Several studies are combining now latency reversing agents together with, for example, neutralizing antibodies, broadly neutralizing antibody, because separately there are data which have been shown that broadly neutralizing antibody decrease the viral load and decrease, at least in animal model, the size of the reservoir. Vaccine therapy also has been shown in some studies with using as a vector, for example, human CMV, to decrease the size of the reservoir. So the reason I mentioned the combination of different approach, probably the latency reversing agents that we have today are not the best one. We have to develop new drug based on a better knowledge on the mechanism of latency, epigenetic mechanism, but also signaling pathway which are involved in latencies. We are learning more and more on that. Gene therapy, I mentioned it because it's a very interesting approach. I'm sure also we can learn from gene therapy. My concern with gene therapy is that it's not an approach will be that will be affordable for resource-limited setting today. However, gene therapy can be used also to try to define new strategy for future treatment. So, again, your question is related to patient acceptance to be enrolled in novel treatment. I'm not too much concerned about that because the patients, again, are very open to start new approaches. It's just a question of dialogue and communication with them, and if there is a reason why, in parallel with the International It's a City initiative, we have an education program where we are going from one country to another and speaking together with the patient representative around the HIV cure research.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the very inspiring talk. And I was just wondering, regarding the patient who are subjecting themselves to the new treatment, are they mostly from industrialized countries, or also they are from developing countries?
Today, I mean, all the patients that has been enrolled in clinical trial for HIV cure research are from industrialized countries. We are starting to discuss, and indeed on board, we have representative of people from resource-limited setting. We found out that they feel that it's too early for them to start on HIV cure. They want to have access to the current antiretroviral treatment. We believe that's not right. We believe that they have also to start to be involved in HIV cure research. And that is also part of our educational program, making a series of training in resource-limited setting today.
Because mainly since I'm from a developing country, and in our data, HIV has not been going down. It has been going up and soaring higher and higher. And like mostly of my experience, I actually have a personal friend who has HIV, and he says that most of the biggest problem in our country is that knowledge is not disseminated properly. People have stigma because people doesn't know, and that in our country, it's a taboo topic to talk about. We don't talk about it. If we feel something that is closely related to a symptom of HIV, we just say that it might be something else. So people go on in their lives transmitting the disease without even knowing it, because mainly people are not largely educated about it. So, my comment is just like, I hope the initiative would also reach out to the poorer countries and more, and that education might be disseminated to them. Maybe not in the levels of academics, but mostly levels of the lay people. I think if in that sense, we will be able to have more participants in your studies, or or we can disseminate the knowledge more so we can strengthen the prevention part of the collective cure that you're participating in.
No, your remark are totally true. I mean, there are some countries where it's very difficult to diagnose. As I mentioned in one of my slides, there is a country where between, let's say, according to the countries, we have around 50% of people that do not know that they are HIV infected, and they arrive at the hospital when they are sick, you know, when they have CD4 count less than 50. And we, of course, they are on treatment at that time, but we know also that if we treat them by antiretroviral antiviral drug so late, the efficacy of the treatment is not as good as the early treatment. So it's a reason why we have to improve reaching all the people. Diagnosing, testing is really the first first priority. And for that, we have to fight against what you said, stigmatization, discrimination. It's part of the education program, I agree with you. But I think to educate the people, we have to work with communities. We have to work with civil society. Because if we base educational program only on health professional, only on researchers, it will not work. So it's in countries that started community-based educational, community-based testing, community-based care and treatment is working much better. So this is for the, let's say, implementation of the tools that we have today. We have to work with communities. It's the only way to go.
Thank you very much.
Hi, thank you again for your lecture. I really enjoyed that. My question also kind of just stemmed off of the previous one, but I'd be really interested to know how these initiatives to get into the communities and to change these behaviors and these assumptions, because that I feel is the biggest barrier to entry. As well as, I mean, even in like developed, more developed countries, there's still this huge stigma where like many places don't even have needle exchange programs, or there's a big stigma against them. So I was curious how like we as scientists can work with the communities, as well as bringing in scientists from some of these communities, like just basically what are the initiatives that are put in place, what are the plans for any initiatives to get into these communities to pass on this information?
I mean, generally we have, I can give you a few examples. I'm working since now years with Vietnam, and you know, Vietnam has, most of the epidemic in Vietnam is related originally to drug users. For years, And in Vietnam, in the past, there were repressive measures against this the key affected population, including, of course, drug users. Then the government decided to have a harm reduction program. However, it was not working at the beginning. It was not working because the population was used to be to repressive measures. They were afraid by the police. There were not enough communication between the police and the Ministry of Interior and the Ministry of Health. And the communities, different organizations, was a lot of organizations representative of key affected population in Vietnam, but they were not organized at all until a clinician, a wonderful woman, Vietnamese woman, it should be local, by the way, that one, decided to try to improve the organization of communities, to strengthen their knowledge, to work together with them in order to educate them and to teach them how to work better together. She did. She did, and she has now a whole network of different organizations going all over the countries, working. Most of them are key affected population. I mean, drug users, sex workers, gay population. And they are involved in implementation program of methadone in the countries, implementation of access to antiretroviral treatment, testing. They are involved themselves, the communities, in testing communities. They go in the different part of the city or in rural area in order to test the population by themselves. And if they are sick, you know, they send to the healthcare system. So they have a good, it's an organization of a network, let's say. Community together with the health infrastructure. And it's progressing. I'm not saying it's perfect, but it's really, really progressing. And the good point, I remember, because we have a program with them on drug users, and last time I was in Vietnam, they made a presentation in the front of me. And at one point, I asked this doctor involved in improving the network of communities, I said, who is talking? And she said, oh, he's a drug user. Oh, I said, I thought it was a nurse or a doctor. So I told her, now I'm very optimistic about the program because we cannot see the difference between a representative of the community and a health professional. So I think it's the way to go. We have really, and they are so much motivated to do that and to work, to try to improve the life of others. I'm sure it's a way to go. Networking is the answer to your question. Networking of the different expertise, including their own expertise.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor, for this wonderful lecture. My question is regarding screening programs. If we try to go through literature online or databases such as United States Preventive Service Task Force, they say that we have a grade A recommendation for screening of adolescents between the age of 15 and 65. And also it's one of the, HIV testing is one of the panels that we ask for, first trimester panel of tests for pregnant women. But such kind of individualized decision for adolescents between the age of 15 and 65 is kind of broad category, which puts a clinician or a nurse at a public health clinic in a very kind of vague decision, like who should be screened, homosexual, partners of a homosexual, partners of a drug abuser, a sex worker, and even going through various policies for the WHO or World Health Organization or other you know, famous health systems such as in Netherlands or Sweden, does not give you a kind of an insight to make a good screening decision to achieve maximum secondary prevention. In your opinion, what is the best, who should be screened for HIV?
Anyone who wants to be screened. Voluntary. Okay. So we have, it's a reason why information education program is very important in order to convince anyone to go for a test. So it's not only key affected population, it's not only adolescents, it's not only the young people, it's really on request of the person. For example, in my country, I can tell you that it has been a recommendation by our Ministry of Health for doctors, the generalists. Each time that they have a visit of one patient, to ask this patient whether he would like to have the test, yes or no. Don't care whether he's part of a key affected group. Just a client. Would you like me to have an HIV test? And also at the same time making information, education of the person, counseling. I thought it was a wonderful idea, personally. Unfortunately, the doctors are not doing it. And when you ask the doctor why you are not doing it, I say, because it's taking time, you know. It's taking time, so I'm losing money. This is not really acceptable. When they are doctors, they have to take responsibility. And the worst for me, it's, of course, this recommendation is also for the hospital. And when you go in the hospital, except in a department of infectious disease where they do it systematically to propose to their patients whether they are coming there for HIV or for anything else.
According
the others are not proposing.
According to your experience, Professor, in such communities which people are not highly educated about HIV and probably they will not ask for the test, who should be screened in such kind of communities?
But it's the health professionals that should propose. It's not, don't wait for the community to ask. The health professional should propose. The decision is from the person you ask. It's voluntary. You cannot force anyone to be tested for HIV. It's a decision, personal decision. It's voluntary testing. And I think this is very important. Otherwise, if we force people to be tested, then there will be fear and they will continue to be stigmatized. We must make people to feel responsible for themselves and for the others. It's not a question of education. Anyone can understand that.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Now it's almost the time, so I would like to close this session with one question from you.
So this is my last question, and I think this is not a question, I'm asking for opinions. So in the long run of 30 years since the HIV discovery, right? So we are just at the beginning, are we standing at the beginning in the HIV research and compare against the HIV infections? Are we in the middle point or are we just in the beginning? Or in for your opinions, for next maybe 20 years to 15 years, does our research should be more focused on which side or which directions should we go for our HIV research? So this is my question.
I mean, if I understood correctly your question, I mean, I already answered the priority for HIV research in the coming years is to try to have a vaccine and to try to have a cure. I mean, all research around cure and vaccine are important. It's not a priority. I mean, both are a priority. So that means it's not only a vaccine trial or cure trial, it's also all the basic research which is needed to understand better the immune response and the mechanism that should be induced to have protective immune response. So it's basic research at the same time. It's to understand better the mechanism of latency and the mechanism of persistence of the reservoir in the body. This is also basic research. It's also to try to have identified better biomarkers to see the efficacy of treatment because the tests that we have today to measure the reservoir of the virus, we know are not the best one. If we don't have novel assay, novel biomarkers to measure the efficacy of future cure strategy, we will not make it. So we need to do that, to do everything at the same time. It's not a one priority. And of course, it's a reason why we have to mobilize the community of scientists, not only one type of researchers. It's a reason we need to have basic science together with preclinical and clinical research. And we need, as I said, social science as well. Because I need to know personally why questions that were asked before, what the patients are ready to accept, yes or no. It's very important for us, the scientists, to know that as well. It's very important also to have study on cost effectiveness, because we want a strategy that will be affordable even for resource-limited countries. So it's not one priority, and we should not think about one priority as individual level. We should think globally. We should think as science, you know, network, consortium of scientists working together.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, finally, we thank again Dr. Barré-Sinoussi for sharing your work.